First of all, thank you very much for the scientific committee that we are able to show our results. But secondly, I would like to thank all the other researchers for giving such an inspirational meeting. I visited a lot of radiology congresses, and the feeling I get here is much more profound than I've experienced before. Thank you for that. Having said this, I would like to present the outcome of the focused ultrasound myoma outcome study called FUMOS. It's a long-term results study of our MRI for treatment. Thanks to our team, I'm able to present this. It's a combination of people from ISALA, Zwolle, and the University Medical Center of Utrecht, and I have nothing to disclose. The rationale of this study is that long-term outcome data after MRI for treatment for uterine fibroids aiming for complete ablations is scarce. And this hampers us in positioning MRI as a first-line treatment in treatment of fibroids and subsequently reimbursement by the insurance companies. So main aim of this study was to evaluate this long-term outcome. We looked at women with some symptomatic uterine fibroids. We had an intervention by MRI-FU, and we looked at reintervention rate and non-perfuse volume in a retrospective cohort. We investigated all women treated with MRI-FU from April 2010 to December 2017, and all patients received a questionnaire about the need for a reintervention, and we also investigated the medical records of all patients. It's important to remember that the first 47 treatments were still limited due to safety guidelines. Here you see this flowchart. We all included, in the beginning, 123 patients. Some patients were not willing to participate. One of the patients deceased. Some patients were treated for another indication, and there were some treatment failures due to different reasons. That left us with 101 patients, of which 14 non-responded. Of the 87 patients who responded, they responded either by questionnaire. Sometimes we had to make phone calls or even email in order to get all the information we needed. Then, the all treatment non-perfuse volume ratio was 48%, but it's kind of interesting to see that the group of non-responders had a higher NPV ratio, and it could be a potential bias. The non-perfuse volume ratio of the non-responders was 58% versus 47%, but it was not significant. The clinical outcome overall of the 101 patients in follow-up time was 62 months. And after excluding the non-responders and the technical failures, we had a 33% re-intervention rate. If we look at these re-interventions, we see that 21% of the patients got a secondary MRI for treatment, 14% had an embolization, and the other 65% had a surgical procedure, of which 7% had a myomectomy, and the other 58% went for hysterectomy. Interesting to see is that after duration of follow-up of 36 months, there's no increment anymore of probability for reintervention as a function of duration of follow-up. If we look at the comparison of the protocols, in the beginning there was an old protocol which was non-restricted. We should not achieve more than 50% non-perfuse volume, and a new protocol that had unlimited non-perfusion achievements, we saw there was a difference in NPV ratio in favor of the new protocol of 54%, and if we look at the number of re-intervention in these two groups, it dropped down to 15%. We show that by means of logistic regression that the NPV ratio is highly statistically significant for predicting the risk of reintervention. So again, if you then stratify the whole group based on NPV ratio and you look at the people who achieved, in which we achieved more than 50%, the reintervention rate was only 6 patients out of 36, and we still had a follow-up of 58 months, and there was no difference in follow-up time. Only there was a difference between these groups in non-responders. And here you can see the graph. By looking at the NPV ratio in a non-restricted group, you see a reduction of the reintervention rate that came down from 45% to 17%. Of course, there are limitations. I always call them the usual suspects. You know them all. But nevertheless, I feel confident that we can share some of the conclusions with you, and maybe we can discuss it later. First of all, the reintervention rate of all patients was about 33% in a follow-up time of 62 months. But most interestingly for future trials is that you don't need a longer follow-up time than 36 months. As known from earlier studies, but we proved it again, is that the MPV ratio had a significant predictive value for the need of a reintervention. And finally, if you look at a group in which we have achieved more than 50% MPV ratio, the reintervention rate drops down to 70%. And it's a very important number, because this is the number which is comparable to other reimbursed therapies such as uterine artery embolization. I'm happy to take any questions and thank you for your attention.
Any questions? Well, that's really important data to substantiate the literature and make us comparable to other reintervention rates, so that's great. And I think the question will evolve over this session is, what is the optimum patient candidacy? How can we start to predict who's going to be a less than 50% NPV versus a more than 50% PV? So thank you for your data, and I think the other lectures that come up to give talks will help us answer that question. Right. Thank you.